Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.
Hey, I'm Andy. If you don't know me, it's probably because I'm not famous. But I did start a men's grooming company called Harry's. The idea for Harry's came out of a frustrating experience I had buying razor blades. Most brands were overpriced, overdesigned, and out of touch. At Harry's, our approach is simple. Here's our secret. We make sharp, durable blades and sell them at honest prices for as low as $2 each. We care about quality so much that we do some crazy things, like buy a world-class German blade factory. Obsessing over every detail means we're confident in offering a 100% quality guarantee. Millions of guys have already made the switch to Harry's, so thank you if you're one of them. And if you're not, we hope you give us a try with this special offer. Get a Harry starter set with a 5-blade razor, weighted handle, shave gel, and a travel cover. All for just $3, plus free shipping. Just go to harrys.com and enter code CONFIDENCE at checkout. That's harrys.com, code CONFIDENCE. Enjoy! Hey, I'm Andy. If you don't know me, it's probably because I'm not famous. But I did start a men's grooming company called Harry's. The idea for Harry's came out of a frustrating experience I had buying razor blades. Most brands were overpriced, overdesigned, and out of touch. At Harry's, our approach is simple. Here's our secret. We make sharp, durable blades and sell them at honest prices for as low as $2 each. We care about quality so much that we do some crazy things, like buy a world-class German blade factory. Obsessing over every detail means we're confident in offering a 100% quality guarantee. Millions of guys have already made the switch to Harry's, so thank you if you're one of them. And if you're not, we hope you give us a try with this special offer. Get a Harry starter set with a 5-blade razor, weighted handle, shave gel, and a travel cover. All for just $3, plus free shipping. Just go to harrys.com and enter code CONFIDENCE at checkout. That's harrys.com, code CONFIDENCE. Enjoy!
When Shopify says you can sell anywhere, they mean it! Woo, hold up! Just got a new sale, order fulfilled, and shipped. Inventory level's good. Whoa! Shopify doesn't mind if you're at sea level. Or on top of the world! You can run and grow your business anywhere. Climbing mountains is never easy, but at least Shopify gives me all the tools I need for my business to hit new beats.
Whether you're selling carabiners or crop tops, start selling with Shopify today and join the platform simplifying commerce for millions of businesses worldwide. We've built the platform so you can keep climbing and grow your business to new heights.
With Shopify, you really can sell to anyone from anywhere.
This is Possibility, powered by Shopify. Start selling online today. Sign up for a free trial at shopify.com/free22. 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 Internet connection required. Not available on mountaintops or seafloors.
Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.
Welcome to Jet Exhausted. I'm Chris.
I'm Rich.
I'm Jess.
And it's September. Well, it's been September. You taught me something right before we started the show. There's a date attached to this song?
21st of September.
I guess I've never really paid attention to the lyrics. I just knew it was September. I didn't know. September. So this is the first day of fall song? A very slim category of one song?
Yeah, I never thought of it that way. And for some reason, I always thought the first day of fall... I always thought the first day of any new season was the 22nd for some
reason. We are rocking out to the autumnal equinox, everybody. Woo! Anyway.
I thought tomorrow was the first day of fall.
That's what I'm saying. I always thought it was the 22nd, but apparently I'm...
Well, I think this year it is. It's a whole astronomy thing about when the sun is equidistant from the equator, and it's just... Fall can be anywhere from like the same thing with spring. It can be anywhere from the 20th through the 22nd, just depending on when, you know, our distance between the sun and the sky at that time. Hmm. There you go. My college astronomy class kicking in.
Wait a minute. Astronomy or astrology?
Astronomy. Okay. No, not.
I thought you said astrology not like, for
no,
the
no,
first.
Not like you're a Pisces. No.
Yeah, I thought you said. I must have misheard you because I was like.
If I said astrology, I meant astronomy.
Well, I also know that it doesn't matter. I was going to say there's a lot of pagan shit involved in the solstice and the seasons, and they got all these different... I'm just like, Can't you just say you just want to be different and we just all agree that, oh, ooh, you're so unique and we can just move on? Like, why do I got to learn, like, well, I believe in. I don't care what you fucking believe in. I don't give a single fuck, man. And I definitely don't give a fuck to sit here and act like what you believe in is worth me learning new shit on the calendar about. But whatever. That's just me. Anyways, what do we have on the agenda for our show today on the 21st of September? That's the day we're recording.
We will be starting with Governor Ron DeSantis is in trouble for...
I heard that.
And has a class action lawsuit filed against him for shipping the immigrants to Martha's Vineyard.
Yeah, I find it hilarious. The news outlets are reporting as the immigrants are suing him. No, an organization is suing him on behalf of the immigrants. But it's okay. It's okay for them to use them as pawns because they think they're more righteous. Either way, these people are pawns, right? They think they're coming here, they're being thrown on a plane, then they get off the plane, then they're thrown on a bus, taken to a military base. Now they're being told they're suing this guy.
Well, it's also, they're saying that it is a violation of their 4th and 14th Amendment rights.
That they don't have? Because they're not citizens?
Yeah, they're not citizens. How can they have rights, right?
Yeah, that does imply that whoever said that, if they have any legal power, they feel that America is legally obligated. Like, it's almost like the Constitution is a human right.
Constitution applies to citizens.
That goes over borders. But no, you're missing what I'm saying. I understand that.
Yeah,
you understand that. They don't understand. Whoever the fuck they are, don't understand it.
They appreciate you using the proper pronouns, by the way.
I used they in the proper way. I used it in the, I don't know.
That's why I said, male or female. No, I said I was, they said they appreciate it.
Okay. I got you. I got what you're saying. I thought you were trying to like go meta.
Maybe I was. We don't know.
They don't know, but we'll tell them when we find out.
Right.
We're talking about one person, by the way, because fuck the English language. Apparently.
Yeah.
Okay, so here's first question I have. Did this lawsuit get filed before or after the DeSantis camp released that the migrants had signed what was it? I don't want to say permission slips, but like
before, because the coming up with the quote unquote permission slips was a rebuttal tactic. Like, no, they said it was cool.
Okay, so they filed it before, so that means he was sitting there with that receipt in his back pocket waiting for this shit.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that's like, thanks for stepping into the bear trap. Like, seriously, that's what this seems like. And two, one of the rebuttals to that I heard was, well, that won't hold up in court because there weren't translators there. Oh, really? Because as someone who graduated high school in Florida, I'm telling you, it's damn hard to find a Spanish-speaking person in the state of Florida.
there was a Spanish version. Now, their rub on the Spanish version is it didn't tell them that the destination was Massachusetts. It just told them it was a sanctuary state.
Massachusetts declared?
In the English version, yes. But...
No. Was it declared a sanctuary state?
Yes.
So, I mean, legal, I'm just saying, like, legal fucking wording and wordplay aside, where's the lie?
Well, we're on the same path because my line of thinking was like, well, in English and Spanish, in both of them, it says you're leaving Texas. So they knew.
And
they knew they were leaving.
Well, I mean, I'm just thinking if they say if you're going to Massachusetts in the English one, but they say a sanctuary city... In the Spanish one, what is the point of that? And the only thing I can come up with is just, I'm not bilingual, that's for goddamn sure, but I do know a little bit, and there's not always a perfect one-to-one translation of words going between languages. Mm-hmm. Some words in other languages are a concept. Like, what is the German word for enjoying someone's misery?
Schadenfreude.
Yes, that's a concept. You know what I'm saying? Like, to explain that, I have to explain the concept of misery to somebody. I can't just go, this is a tablet. This is what you call this because that's what we call it. You know what I'm saying? So there might be that, or it just might be legal, like I said, wordplay to leave wiggle room legally, which, I mean, it could be a little column A, column B.
And people in Martha's Vineyard send them to a military base? Did exactly what they said they were pissed off about?
And then called in the National Guard.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm not shocked about the National Guard, but like, I know the people were, and I'm like, really? Martha's Vineyard, you think for a second those people that were shipped in there were treated better than any homeless person who would wander, who's a natural born American citizen who would wander into their past their city fucking
absolutely.
They fared like a lot better than an American born homeless person. So
bunch of brown woke trophies they could parade in front of their friends.
But I heard that they shipped them to Cape Cod. So is it a military base on Cape Cod?
I'm guessing so.
There's a military base on Cape. I thought Cape Cod was like
maybe naval.
Yes, Martha's Vineyard's migrants sent to Cape Cod for the New York Post.
I mean, like Coast Guard, maybe? Like I would fit like a naval base.
It's the Cape Cod's the curlicue in Massachusetts, so it's got to be. I'm thinking Navy.
Well, I mean, if I'm remembering correctly, I think Cape Cod's big thing is like their baseball league. They have a summer baseball, like minor league. Like they have a bunch of teams in that area. I think that's like one of their big things. I don't know. I might be getting that from someplace else. Anyways, it doesn't matter. So, I mean, well, first of all, what law firm filed this fucking lawsuit on behalf of these people? I highly doubt any of them.
They're called Alianza Americans, a network of groups supporting immigrants, filed the class action lawsuits.
When I heard their name, I'm like, you're woke. I get it.
Right. They filed the class action lawsuits with three unnamed migrants that DeSantis relocated.
Jose, Hector.
See, I'm just shocked. That makes sense. It's some sort of organization group, whatever. Who did this, so they want to get their name out there. I'm surprised it wasn't just a law firm up there trying to score brownie points with local. Like we have local here in Michigan, we have some local attorneys that you go outside the state, maybe you've heard of. Jeffrey Feiger might be, you might know him out of state. But like Mike Morris, Joanna, whatever the fuck her name is.
Jumana Kairos.
Yeah, the former stripper who looks like she got...
Oh, she is a former stripper?
No, I'm just saying. She looks like a former stripper who got her law degree.
She looks like someone who went to a fucking plastic surgeon and gave her a Barbie doll head and said, give me this.
That's why she looks like a former stripper. But, like, I just thought it was one of those type of local celebrity law firms. Like, we'll file this for you and we'll get so much goodwill in the community because it's got to be a lost cause, right? This is a ceremonial filing of a lawsuit just to basically gum up the works just to say you did something, right?
I bet you this is a bunch of, like, 20-something fresh out of law school.
Oh, this is paralegals working this case like a motherfucker. And it's paralegals, it's like, hey, do you want to work it on your off time? Because we really are not in a big hurry to pay this shit.
Well, I just meant the lawyers that are involved. Yeah, these are like... To me, it's just the same people who are fretting like, oh, you're using them as pawns and these are people and stop your political theater. Isn't this the exact same shit?
Oh, well, I mean, yeah, to me, they're all immoral pieces of shit feeding off the misery of society. Lawyers,
like you just
drug
think
dealers, all the same thing.
Like you just think you're on the righteous side. You're doing the exact same thing.
Actually, I'll say this. Drug dealers, I think, are better than lawyers because I actually want some of the drugs that I've gotten from drug dealers, and they've never given me a bad trip or brought me misery or any problems. Like shrooms, never had a bad trip. So why? I don't think a shroom dealer is a bad drug dealer. So I think if you deal shrooms, you're better than most lawyers. Congratulations. I mean, it's a low bar. You just hopped over, but you know, you did get over it.
Hey, it's the easiest way to get over the bar. Make sure it's low.
So, but you're selling like meth, heroin. Yeah, fuck you.
All right, so, Jess, 14th and 16th, because I'm like, what is it? What's this lawsuit for? So 14th and 16th?
Hold on. I've scrolled way down in the article now. The 4th and 14th Amendment and the Civil Rights Act of 1964.
Well, the 14th Amendment gave citizenship to all people born in the U.S. So, see you later. And let's see, 4th Amendment.
4th Amendment's illegal search and seizure and detainment. 4th Amendment.
Well, they're saying that they were kidnapped. That they, not kidnapped, that they were
illegally detained.
Yeah.
Not if they voluntarily went.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, if they're trying to claim it's an illegal detainment, then they're saying it's basically false arrest. But if they were never put into custody, they were just in federal custody because they came across the border and were shipped federally. You see what I'm saying? Like, I don't even see how they can fucking name DeSantis personally.
He used Florida funds. It wasn't federal. He used some kind of fund for some.
Wow.
But still, it's not. They weren't detained. The fact that they signed, that they went willingly, that there you go. There's the 4th Amendment thrown out. Because they weren't detained. If they voluntarily went.
Yeah, DeSantis says all of this was voluntary.
And, I mean, of course, I saw an article about this, and it was an article, I believe, on the Huffington Post. So you can imagine the tone they took with this. But I mean, like, it was like, oh, well, they were given a $10 food voucher for McDonald's and blah, 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 and this and this.
Hey, man, you and I both know you didn't make $10 go pretty far at McDonald's.
I'm like, I'm
the right deal.
I'm just, and like, they're
talking. Use the app?
They're talking all this shit, like the fact that they weren't put in some fucking paddy wagon and chained up in the back and given the fucking Baltimore fucking joyride all the way up to Massachusetts. They want to, like, they want to act like that's what happened. But here's the deal: it's like, these people were probably treated better on their trip up there than they were once they got there. They were probably treated better by Florida and then sent out of Florida and on their way to Massachusetts than they were when they got to Martha's Vineyard.
You know what they didn't have before they came here? $10.
Well, no, I'm just, because, like, the attitude in this, in the article that I read, and I, and like I said, I'm not sure if it's Huffington.
We put the kids in the cages and threw them in the cargo bay of the plane.
It's one of the,
took them up to Martha's Vineyard.
It's like, yeah, even if it's not Huffington Post, it's like along the lines. You get what I'm saying. And it was just very sarcastic, like what was done for them. And I'm thinking, what the fuck did y'all do? Literally, I've seen three or four different YouTubers go online in real time. And they were streaming, I've watched a couple of them stream it live, and I've watched ones that have recorded this, you know, live streams that I've watched it later. And they look up Airbnbs, and they're like 50 people, right? We can house 50 people in these nice Airbnbs that are sitting empty in Martha's Vineyards because it's off fucking season. And we could do it, I think it was like for like $2,000-$4,000 somewhere, like for like a week, like something like that. It was like something like $10,000, like, overall, like one guy was like, that's the most with the fattest per diem these people have ever seen in their lives because they don't even know what the fuck a per diem is. And he's like, $10,000. This is Martha's Vineyard. They don't have the money or the resources for that. You're Martha's Vineyard. I somehow fucking doubt that. Probably the bill to water the
dude,
fucking,
yeah, it was
the lawn outside the mayor's house is $10,000
a month. It was 50 people. It wasn't 500.
That's what. Okay, and even then,
that's
it's like
50 people. That's a family reunion.
Even then, how many times have we heard these sanctuary cities that are nowhere near a border that anyone's trying to get across, by the way, talk all this shit like, oh, it's only 1,500, only 2,000 people. You got 50 people and it shut down Martha's Vineyard. It shut it down according to them. They could not handle this. They were swamped. They have a housing crisis in Martha's Vineyard.
I mean, I know it is not the best way to be doing it, but I understand why these governors are doing it. I think Abbott's saying, like, I'm trying to show, pretty much trying to show these sanctuary cities, hey, here's the reality of a border state. Yeah, exactly. This was just 50 people, all right? 50 people just came in the last fucking hour in a border town. You know, I get the point they're trying to make. Like, listen, you relax the border policies. Welcome to my reality, fuckface. Like, it's easy when you're up in New York and your border is a giant, there's a fucking ocean between you and all the people trying to come in. There ain't fucking...
Well, you're telling me that the wave of Canadians streaming across the border at Niagara Falls,
right?
Yeah, into upstate New York. Going, no, I've always been a Bills fan, eh? You know what I'm saying?
White guys hanging out at Home Depot.
I'm here for the soccer game, eh?
Eating poutine.
I'm here to see the Bills.
Taking all of our jobs.
But once again, I think the thing that's getting lost, and I haven't really seen this except for Crystal and Sagar on Breaking Points on their news channel really go at this, is this is just a mask off, flat out in our face moment of not in my backyard, NIMBY, like a motherfucker.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody gives a shit. Everybody's like, well, he shouldn't have sent them people, or he did send them people. Good. He owned the libs. And it's like, okay, how about the fact that we just had our fucking quote unquote leaders, who really aren't our leaders, our employees who we fucking hire, basically show that like they have no intent to walk the fucking talk at all. And when it comes to them, and it comes to people who can actually affect them as far as donations, no. We'll get these brown people out of your way. Sorry. I'm not hearing diversity is our strength very much from Martha's Vineyard in the last week. Okay? You know what I'm saying? I'm not hearing the same fucking, the same righteousness coming from those areas that I've heard for fucking decades. We've all heard for decades coming from those areas. And it's fucking amazing that everyone's letting them get away with it. And every one of us should be shoving it in their cocksucking fucking faces every second we fucking can. Because they're fucking hypocrites.
But Rich, the Obamas stay on Martha's Vineyard.
I don't give a fuck who stays there. The best piece of pussy in the world I've ever had could stay there. Fuck that bitch if she's fucking talking that shit. Because, I mean, here's the thing. It's never fucking the people talking this shit. This is the case in point. These are the people who will vote and put in the power, the people who talk all this inclusion shit. When it comes down to it, they don't want it in their backyard. These aren't our people. These aren't our fucking problems. I mean, it's just so frustrating. Oh, it's enraging. It's enraging because we own the libs. We own the Republicans. Y'all just arguing over what slave master whips you the least, aren't you? At least black people knew they were slaves. You remain clueless. Go ahead. Root for your side.
I would love to see just one of these governors, like, just be real and be like, yeah, and that was just one fucking bus. You got a drop in the bucket into my world. And look at how you're fucking, especially, I don't understand New York City. Really, New York City? You don't have the infrastructure? Come on now.
Well, isn't that, I mean, sorry, I have no lost love for the state of New York for the most part, or New York City. But isn't that like a New York City go-to playbook to claim that they're like the cultural fucking center of the goddamn universe, the best of everything? Everything comes through the Big Apple. The city's so nice we had to name it twice. All this bullshit. But yet the minute it comes for them to cough the fuck up something more than empty platitudes about themselves, we don't have the infrastructure. We don't have the money for this. Motherfucker, then why does it cost $15 million a second to live in a broom closet? Explain that to me.
Right.
You fucking cocksucker. Explain that, huh? No, you can't, can you? No. Huh. But you're the best at everything, but you can't fucking put up 50 fucking homeless people. We know that because they're just all over the street in New York.
Right.
Well, and Abbott's been talking for a long time about being overwhelmed and too many people coming through, and border control is overwhelmed, and literally we can respond within 48 hours whenever 50 migrants get put in a wealthy area. The problem's handled for 50 people.
And once again, where was it? It's just like I said, Summer of Love 2.0. Riot. Mostly peaceful rioting for the whole summer. Literally took over fucking 7 blocks of a fucking American city for 2 weeks. Lawless. Just complete anarchy. No problem. March on the fucking Capitol. This is an insurrection. They tried to fucking overthrow the United States government. Yes, because that's how it works. You go stand in a building and go, I'm the president now, and everybody listens to you.
Yeah.
That's exactly how this fucking works. Get the fuck out of my face with that childish bullshit. Sorry.
What's that movie? I'm the captain now. Yeah, that's how it works.
Like, it's just, it's constant with these people. It's constant. It's a pattern. It's a pattern of people saying, wait a minute, the official story doesn't add up, of corporate social media, corporate news, attacking, doing their best to remove and silence and deplatforming anyone who fucking says that or agrees or reposts or shares that opinion. Time passes, and then all of a sudden, it's on the back page of the newspaper on a Sunday or on a Wednesday fucking afternoon edition, and nobody but old people who are ready to die by, there's a little fucking half a paragraph going, they were right the whole time. And there's no apologies. There's no reckoning. There's no fucking, there's no consequences. There's none. And I'm just like, this is to me, if I'm in Massachusetts, and I have any fucking, if you still think you want to vote, I'm voting out every single politician in that fucking state. Y'all are, that talked all this sanctuary state shit and then turned around and did this. You're fucking hypocrites, and you proved it. You proved it. Because how many of them have made how many millions of fucking dollars? How many politicians have made millions of dollars based on this fucking one issue?
Lots.
Exactly. Billions of dollars. Fuck millions. Billions over the years. And here we go. Once again, when the fucking rubber meets the road, we find out they turn tail and run. They're chicken shit. And they send everybody else to do their dirty work. Here, National Guard, which is, by the way, the people who live in that state. Here, go fucking handle this shit.
Take these poors away from us.
Yeah, you're the poor people in our neighborhood who had to join the National Guard. Yeah. Like, still, you're the poorest person in the fucking, Martha's Vineyard National Guard unit.
Right.
But, you still, like... That's their attitude, flat out. I mean, so,
and you know, and
keep worshiping these people. Keep putting them back in office, because it'll change. It'll change this time, won't it?
I will say, I give some of these governors credit, because you do notice where they're not sending people, right? We've heard they're not sending them to California, because they're like, they got their own problem over there. They'll need to be. California's got enough Mexicans. We need to be sending any more there.
California has some of the videos I've watched about their homeless situation is just amazing,
dude.
Like, not in a good way whatsoever,
dude. You can walk. We can go to a Rite Aid right now in the Bay Area and just take like a grand worth of shit and walk out, and no one would stop us.
That's the least of my concern. Like, if I'm living in that area at this point, like I the shit I'm seeing, like.
Well, you know,
it's just complete lawlessness, like people just setting up tents on people's front yards and going, I dare you to come out and tell me to move because I'll fuck you up. Yo, that's bro, that's strong arm. That's prison time.
Well, I say try that in a Midwestern state.
Well, you are doing it in San Francisco.
Yeah.
Okay. And I mean,
try that here.
What is Philippe and Stefan going to do? Come out and redecorate your tent for you?
Around here, white or black, the next sound in that conversation is click, click.
More times than not. Yeah. That's the universal sound for you just fucked up.
Yeah. Excuse me? I couldn't hear you over the sound of you getting the fuck off of my lawn.
But out there, I mean, like, it's like that. And I mean, there was a news fucking story. They went out to this neighborhood, and there's just like these fucking pop-up caravans and campers. None of these people looked like immigrants. All of these people looked just a lot of fucking white old men. And when I say old men, I mean, I guess like over 35 and older. I mean, to me, that's oldest. That's old to be homeless. That's homeless takes the piss out of you. You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, you're living on the street and you're like 50. That's like being 100 living in the house. You know what I'm saying? Like the house cat years versus an outdoor cat years. You know what I'm saying? But, I mean.
I don't like that. You're not down for task force that roam the street picking up human feces? That's not the world you want to live in?
Well, that's the other thing. That was never being done. It was all promised by these politicians, and it was never done. Now, here's the thing. You go into the politicians' neighborhoods. You go into the upper-class neighborhoods. You go into the neighborhoods where they filmed the exterior for the fucking intro to Full House, and there's no shit and piss on the streets because those homeless people aren't allowed in those areas. They are kept out. But you go into literally working-class areas that are comparable to the house that you live in right now, in the neighborhood you live in right now, and it's lawlessness in the fucking in the neighborhood, and nobody gives a fuck. And I mean, like, people are just hostage in their homes. This isn't row housing in Baltimore, in a burnt out town, or, you know, some fucking dilapidated fucking house that's the last one on a block in Detroit somewhere. This is motherfucking San Francisco.
Yeah.
There's money in that motherfucking state. This ain't even Oakland across the bay. This is San Francisco.
This is a city where if you make $100,000 a year, you're poor.
Yes. That's real shit right there. That is real shit. That is no bullshit. So I just this, the whole that's what gets to me. I don't understand why the
Scratch that.
I understand why the mainstream media isn't focusing on the fact that a bunch of politicians were hypocrites. But I don't understand why more people aren't upset about it. And it seems like it's almost one of these things like,
oh, the governor of California is about to run for president because it's in such great shape.
Oh, no, no. All the upset I'm seeing is coming from, like, the people who, like, support the Martha's Vineyard shit, which flies in the face of everything that they just posted on their social media the day before. But, you know, the minute it happened, and it was like, wait, who sent them? Oh, Daddy D sent them? This is horrible. They can't, this is now an immigrant crisis in Martha's Vineyard. And I'm like, there's never been an immigrant crisis in Martha's Vineyard unless the paychecks didn't clear. That's the only immigrant crisis in Martha's Vineyard. And let's be honest, y'all are paying them under the table anyways.
See, I thought, hey, look, more workforce. We got more people to mow the lawns, more people watch kids.
Dude, honestly, I'm, bro.
By the way, it's weird. It's weird when you say it too.
Say what?
Daddy D.
Oh. Anyway, I used to say chocolate Jesus, and that used to really make people uncomfortable. White people. All white people, by the way. No black person was ever uncomfortable. They always laughed their ass off. They thought it was hilarious.
Oh, it's great. I know exactly what you're talking about. Barack Obama.
But, yeah, so. All right. Well, anything else to add on this particular subject?
Stay tuned. I mean, either way, it's all, both sides, it's all political posturing, but it's funny to me to see just the pearl clutching coming from the other side about they're not political pawns and now this. You know, they're suing you. No, they're not suing him. An organization is suing him.
Guys, I mean, I feel like I don't even need to ask this, but I'll ask you anyways. Like, am I wrong in thinking that we all agree that, like, of course they're political pawns? That's what the fuck they are in this fucking situation. That's all they are. I mean, what the fuck did you expect? They literally fucking opened Pandora's box by talking about some shit that wasn't in, worrying about the neighbor's fucking yard instead of watering your own lawn.
Yeah.
Talking about fucking all these states, these border states that have motherfuckers floating across goddamn 90 miles of fucking shark infested ocean to get here and shit on a goddamn door. Right? What are you talking about? You don't know what the fuck you're talking about up there in Massachusetts. Shut the fuck up. But no, they got to pop their mouth off. I'm sorry. I could just go on and on about it. It's just because it's not just this. This is what happens anytime there's any type of you try to do something to help a community. A lot of these communities go, not in my backyard. And so what happens? They end up either, a lot of times, these things die on the vine. They never come to fruition, or they end up in the worst fucking neighborhoods possible. And a lot of times, they're nonprofits. They're not making bank anyways. And they're there to help people. And the neighborhood they're in is such a shitty neighborhood, they're driven out of business by crime and fucking vandalism and nonsense that goes on in it. I mean, you're the Democratic Party. I expect this from the Republicans, because Republicans never fucking said they were the party of, we're going to worry about the downtrodden, okay? More and more, yeah, I feel like they're starting to embrace the middle class and the working class. But when, Chris, especially when we were young, they were not the class of the working class.
Oh, no. They were the rich people.
Exactly. So,
well, no, I think more what's happening is the middle class is embracing them, because most of the people in the middle class are being told by the Democrats, especially, like, take us, right? Like,
you're not welcome here.
Yeah.
That's just all there is to it.
Middle-aged white guy, peace. We don't fucking want you.
Yep. And I mean, like, this, I was going to bring this up, but I mean, like, one of the people that is commenting more and more on exactly what you're like, what we're talking about, is Bill Maher on his show. And I call it
my new favorite podcast. I have been checking into Club Random.
Is that the one where he like gets high with people? And
yeah, it's where he doesn't really talk about politics. And he's actually a comedian. It's fucking great.
Well, no, I've seen clips, but I've never like sat and listened to the whole thing. Yeah, it's like the it's the phobicking of Bill Maher, because you know, calling it Red Pill was problematic because
sci-fi. We don't want to be associated with right-wing fascist. Like, you're just kind of proving our point, but.
It is funny all the times he brings up all this stuff, and it's just like, it's shit that 2-3 years ago, literally that short of a time period, like right before COVID really hit, he was laughing about and laughing at people who were warning about could happen on his show. Now it happens. And he's like, okay, maybe I shouldn't have been laughing. This is ridiculous, blah, 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 blah. And it's amazing because every time that clip hits YouTube and it gets posted on social media, you just see all the people come out the woodwork to start talking about, I can't believe I ever liked you. You've been a fascist in fucking disguise all this whole time. Blah, 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 blah. You're like Dennis Miller was. You had us all fooled. And here's the thing.
What?
Everyone. And by the way, real quick aside on that, the Dennis Miller thing, that's just people showing their ignorance, because even the people who were on Saturday Night Live in the 80s with Dennis Miller was like, Dennis Miller was never a fucking like, died in the wool.
He's
commie.
Never bleeding heart. No.
No. He is very much a centrist. Y'all just didn't, you just didn't understand because you were seeing it going, oh, he makes jokes about Reagan, so he must hate all fucking Republicans. No, he hates everybody. Well, he did back then. Now he's fucking flat out a Republican.
Well, so you listen to him now, he's definitely right wing.
Oh, yeah. No, but once again, he was pushed there because he did. A story like his, what happened? They asked him, what happened? What pushed you from being, you know, quote unquote, seen as a liberal icon to being a conservative? And he goes, no, I'm not changed. What changed is everyone around me. And what changed is when I went to fucking Times Square and I was like, I'm not having to like keep my head on a swivel and there's not people coming up trying to fucking mug me and stick a gun in my face and blah blah blah, and there's families. And I remember the Times Square as a taxi driver in the 70s. This is like fucking Disney World. And they're like, yeah, because of that fascist fucking Giuliani, isn't it horrible? And he's like, it's horrible to be safe in Times Square,
right?
And that he was like, and when they were like, no, you can't support him and you can't like what he's done because he's a Nazi. This was the 90s, by the way, folks.
Yeah.
Late 90s, early 2000s. So this shit's been coming for a while for everybody who's been paying attention. To use a term, who's been awake maybe for all this, but, you know, don't want to co-opt anything. But yeah, I mean, it was absolutely, that was the case. He was like, that's when I realized these people are fucking retarded. Like, what do you want? You want complete anarchy? Just lawlessness? Like that? Who does that help? Who does that serve? How does that help you with anything? It doesn't. But.
No, it's a feeling I can identify with, because we started doing this show. You call me right wing, I'd be like, oh no, hey, stop. But COVID, man, it kind of turned a corner in COVID, because all the people who've been screaming, you know, you're authoritarian and fascist, turned authoritarian and fascist when the shit really hit the fan. Like that was my quote unquote red pill moment, is like, oh, it's not the side clamping down that everyone thought would clamp down. It is it's the everybody love everybody and the power to the people side. Well, apparently not when the shit's going down. It is shut up, stay the fuck where you are. We'll let you know when it's time to fucking do like it. It was eye opening for me.
Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.
Hey. I'm Andy. If you don't know me, it's probably because I'm not famous. But I did start a men's grooming company called Harry's. The idea for Harry's came out of a frustrating experience I had buying razor blades. Most brands were overpriced, overdesigned, and out of touch. At Harry's, our approach is simple. Here's our secret. We make sharp, durable blades and sell them at honest prices for as low as $2 each. We care about quality so much that we do some crazy things, like buy a world-class German blade factory. Obsessing over every detail means we're confident in offering a 100% quality guarantee. Millions of guys have already made the switch to Harry's, so thank you if you're one of them. And if you're not, we hope you give us a try with this special offer. Get a Harry starter set with a 5-blade razor, weighted handle, shave gel, and a travel cover. All for just $3, plus free shipping. Just go to harrys.com and enter code CONFIDENCE at checkout. That's harrys.com, code CONFIDENCE. Enjoy!
As we get older, we start to notice our parents could use a little help. Help with grocery shopping, getting to appointments, and just keeping up with things around the house. For the times when we can't be there, Care.com makes it easy to find senior caregivers who live nearby and know just how to help. And since all caregivers at Care.com are background checked, you can be confident that your mom or dad is getting support from someone you can trust. Find senior caregivers for your parents at Care.com.
Grand Canyon University, a Christian university, is one of the largest and fastest-growing universities in the country, offering over 250 engaging programs online. GCU integrates the free market system and its welcoming Christian worldview perspective into its academic programs and throughout its online campus. GCU's online students received over $144 million in scholarships in 2021. Visit gcu.edu/myoffer to see the scholarships you qualify for. Find your purpose at Grand Canyon University.
Hey, I'm Andy. If you don't know me, it's probably because I'm not famous. But I did start a men's grooming company called Harry's. The idea for Harry's came out of a frustrating experience I had buying razor blades. Most brands were overpriced, overdesigned, and out of touch. At Harry's, our approach is simple. Here's our secret. We make sharp, durable blades and sell them at honest prices for as low as $2 each. We care about quality so much that we do some crazy things, like buy a world-class German blade factory. Obsessing over every detail means we're confident in offering a 100% quality guarantee. Millions of guys have already made the switch to Harry's, so thank you if you're one of them. And if you're not, we hope you give us a try with this special offer. Get a Harry starter set with a 5-blade razor, weighted handle, shave gel, and a travel cover. All for just $3 plus free shipping. Just go to harrys.com and enter code CONFIDENCE at checkout. That's harrys.com, code CONFIDENCE. Enjoy.
New message.
What up, what up? It's Heather's cousin. You dated her in college, or maybe you were just in the same class. Anyway, I heard you bought a boat, my man. Let's hit the water. Oh, and Heather told me you always liked snacks and stuff, so I could totally bring some chips.
When you get a boat, you also get new friends. Make sure Progressive's one of them, and get coverage today for as little as $100 a year.
Hey, also, I'm a little short on cash, so can you cover the chips? Thanks. I can see why Heather liked you.
Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Annual premium for basic liability policy not available in all states.
Hey, I'm Andy. If you don't know me, it's probably because I'm not famous. But I did start a men's grooming company called Harry's. The idea for Harry's came out of a frustrating experience I had buying razor blades. Most brands were overpriced, overdesigned, and out of touch. At Harry's, our approach is simple. Here's our secret. We make sharp, durable blades and sell them at honest prices for as low as $2 each. We care about quality so much that we do some crazy things, like buy a world-class German blade factory. Obsessing over every detail means we're confident in offering a 100% quality guarantee. Millions of guys have already made the switch to Harry's, so thank you if you're one of them. And if you're not, we hope you give us a try with this special offer. Get a Harry starter set with a 5-blade razor, weighted handle, shave gel, and a travel cover. All for just $3 plus free shipping. Just go to harrys.com and enter code CONFIDENCE at checkout. That's harrys.com, code CONFIDENCE. Enjoy.
Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.
Jess, I don't mean to put you on blast, but I imagine this is a subject that you have you have a few thoughts on concerning all the firsthand experience you have with COVID and the fallout of the bullshit fucking opening people's eyes in your life.
Did we?
I'm so sorry. I didn't realize I had muted my mic. I'm over here like, yeah, uh-huh. And I said to Chris, I was like, hey, we're happy to have you. And nope, over here muted. No, absolutely. I do. And I've watched a lot of fallout from it. Like, in my family in particular, you know, I've always been raised very conservative, but I've watched a lot of people who I had vastly differing views from come around and be like, I don't know what's going on. I had a girl come and tell me, she's like, I'm going to vote for Trump, but if my family ever finds out, then literally they will disown me.
Hey, nice tolerant family you got there.
Oh, ugh.
Who's supposed to be on the side of tolerance?
Just on the side. I started hearing about 2004, 2005. There was a real push online on a lot of different forums.
that it is irrational and illogical to tolerate intolerance. I mean, I'm sure that it looks good, like when you put it in, like, I don't know, on a quote, and make a meme of it.
Cool in a dorm room while you were exhaling.
But yeah, like that's the thought process that these people have. Just so you know, so that's what you're dealing with right off the bat. I just want to throw that out there. Sorry, go ahead, Jess.
Oh, I mean I think that's all I had to add into that. Unless you're talking about specifically with COVID and seeing people who, you know, had their families like completely not disown them, but uninvite them from holidays and shit, you know?
Well, I mean, yeah, that's the madness that we've all either experienced. I think on this show, for the most part, like, it's been secondhand, I think. You know what I'm saying? I don't think you haven't told me any stories about being uninvited from shit.
My family was all simpatico on don't get my mom sick. That was all.
Well, that's where it comes down to, like, who's the most vulnerable.
Yeah. That's really all it did. There was no trust. All the politics and shit started later, and most of my family's kind of aligned. But it all came from, like, don't get the 72-year-old with a stent in her heart and diabetes sick. Mm-hmm. Like, that's where it all came from.
And see, that's a logical point. You know, I'm not with the people who are like, oh, you live your life in fear because you fucked. Oh, you're gonna kill granny and blah blah blah. And it's like, I get it. I get how cringeworthy it is. Be like, don't be the one who doesn't get the shot and be the one that kills granny. I get that. But what you just described is someone who's very high risk and should be concerned about getting the fucking seasonal flu, let alone the flu on steroids.
Oh, guess what? She gets flu shot every year.
Yeah, exactly.
That's and what guess what? She listens to, well, she used to, I guess, tribute to the old man, Rush, and now whoever's replaced him still listens to it every day. But she's a very conservative woman. But guess what? I think I said this before. She's a very conservative woman who realized she owns a human body and realized that there were times she wore the masks. She got the shots because she didn't want to get sick.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I'm saying. Like, I think hindsight is always going to be 20/20. Looking back, you can be like, oh, we overreacted, blah, blah, blah. But see, to me, that's a logical, that's a reasonable reaction and way to go about dealing with shit. Hey, look, no need to fucking put you at risk. If we don't have to.
Yeah.
Real simple. That's for everybody who likes the no contact deliveries. DoorDash and Grubhub and all that shit was around before COVID. I did that shit on and off before COVID a few times. There was no such thing as no contact deliveries.
I fucking love it. There's no need to make small talk with you anymore just because you're bringing me my food. Just leave it. I'll tip you. Have a nice day.
I mean, but like, that's because of COVID. You know what I'm saying? Like,
dude, no, my two favorite things from COVID are going to be contactless delivery and curbside. Those are going to be my two favorite. Those things are never going away. And I love that.
Why curbside? Go look at your groceries, damn it.
No, I'm thinking, like, I haven't.
Groceries?
Well, different kind of groceries.
Yeah. Well,
I've gotten out of the car at the dispensary in like
green shit
6 months.
Yeah. Oh, now you're just rubbing it in. Go look at your weed, damn it. Think of all of us who can't.
Move. It's 20% of the country at this point.
Yeah. None with any politics I like.
Just wait, it's coming. I think the key to your part of the country is Florida.
Yeah, they're medical, I think, right?
Right. Well, Florida's got to get wreck. Florida and Texas, actually. Florida, Texas get it. It'll just eventually, the South will acquiesce.
Well, I also heard something that was weird. I don't know if this is true or accurate, but Kevin Smith of Jay and Silent Bob and, you know, the View Askew movies fame, he has his own fucking, like, line. So does Jay. I mean, basically everyone involved with Kevin Smith has a line of weed, basically, through him, or a strain named after him or something. But you can't.
Hold on, I gotta sit down.
Yeah, I know you're shocked.
Yeah.
Right? It's just what he built his entire fucking career based on. But you can't. Apparently, you can't get his shit here in the state of Michigan, and he's been, like, because of the different laws, because it's coming from New Jersey and it's not produced or whatever, blah 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 here and all this shit. And a guy in Ohio was like, well, we got it, and we have pretty much the same laws as you, except for apparently unless you are a medical patient in Ohio, you can't smoke flower. You have to get, like, edibles or, like, a vape product.
Well, how does that
or
wreck?
Shatter? That's what they're saying. They're saying they did. Motherfuckers were talking back and forth on this page and claiming to be from Ohio and, like, yeah, you can't buy it recreationally. And I'm just like,
mean, correct. They don't have rec in Ohio.
Yeah, but they're saying that you can buy vape shit recreationally. And you can buy, like, fucking, like, the shatter shit, whatever. What is that fucking shit? The dab stuff.
Yeah. Well, it's shatter, butter. It's many names.
Okay,
there's
cool.
Different types.
It's like halfback, running back. Yeah. There's a mini. Yes, yes. There's a backfield. Yes, yes, yes. So, yeah. And I'm just like, okay. And I'm like, that's weird. That's, like, is that the last hurdle? The reason I bring it up is not because whether it's accurate or not. But, I mean, like, I could see some state being like, well, you can't buy the leaf tobacco, you know, or
no, it's
shit.
Florida had a rec I believe they finally changed it. But Florida's medical program started to, like, you could only, like, eat it.
Yeah, that's one of, which is a completely different high. I mean, but if you're using it for pain, especially nerve pain, eating it's better than, but it. I wouldn't want someone to eat what you would have to eat to feel no nerve pain and then go about their day. We're talking like 50 milligrams minimum, probably.
I warm up with 50 milligrams, buddy.
Dude, bro.
That's my Sunday morning.
I tapped out at 350 one time. When I started hearing shit, I was like, okay, I don't want to start seeing shit.
No, I told
shit.
You, 200's the one where I was like, too high, too high.
Well, you were in a plane, too.
But still, no, that was just, when my body was humming, I was like, no. I don't want to be debilitating high. I just want to be high. 200 was debilitating high.
No, and I mean, like, I get you, I get you. But no, I just was wondering if that's like some, because it's always the people who don't want legal weed are going to look for every little last argument until they're finally just fucking out of shit.
That fire,
everything is fucking.
The water's already been dumped on that fire. At this point, we're
okay. Gotcha.
Just, dude. I'll use another metaphor. You're putting a horse back in the barn. I mean, it's 20% of the country's recreational. Almost all of it.
36. Was it 36 states have
medical? Yeah, like it's over. Like, dude, it's give it another decade or two. It'll be legal nationally.
Oh, well, since we're sitting here talking predictions, now would be a good time for me. See, we're not going to bury our retractions at the end of the show. We do it right here in the middle, so I'm going to do where I was wrong. I've been beating this fucking war drum for this fucking shit for so long, and recently I've been proven completely wrong. When it comes to certain corporations, I've been saying for fucking a couple of years now, when people go, like, when the new Star Wars or whatever comes out, and, you know, the fans are like, this is garbage. Once the, you know, list of you're racist, you're sexist, all that shit gets done, and they actually address the points you bring up, eventually what you end up hearing is they're not making it for you. And I have argued with friends, with strangers, with people on fucking various podcasts on this network to the point where I was, like, ready to pull my fucking hair out that there ain't no billion-dollar corporation who wants to be a trillion-dollar corporation talking about let's watch money fly out the fucking window because we don't want to target certain people. Disney has basically come out and admitted flat out they make certain shit for certain people. That is their new fucking business model, and that is them going forward. There is no more one-size-fits-all Disney. And if you remember correctly, last week I brought up about the leaks about the corporate leaks about how they're, like, you know, moving stuff around, trying to get away from, like, political agendas and stuff. Disney is more than happy to use that as their new marketing metrics. So instead of, like, I guess, like, going after 18 to 40 or 54-year-old women for She-Hulk, right? Like, that, mm-hmm. that age, they're going after the wine moms. And that definition is, I mean, it's,
well, that's,
yeah, I mean, we have a vague definition, but there's no hardcore static definition.
Let's
to
just
that.
Say women 35 to 54.
But this is the thing. Like, they're not even trying to make it appealing to anybody else. They don't give a fuck about any other demographics opinion about this because they are literally making these very cheaply on the fucking quick and pushing them out. And what gave away their game is the new Star Wars show is coming out on Disney Plus, and the new Star Wars show they sunk money into, and you can see it on screen. And when I'm talking, see it on screen. In Kenobi, you had ships in space with chairs and would lose gravity and the chairs wouldn't go anywhere. They weren't bolted down. They weren't attached to the floor because they were moved around like you do a chair on a fucking floor. This one's got like the old school, like they put the money and the time into it and they're marketing it flat out as this is Star Wars for adults. And I'm going, holy fuck.
But middle-aged women, that's always where the money is at. I mean, it's... When you go back to our media training, right? We were told, what was the most popular format at the time? It was adult contemporary. Who listened to it? Middle-aged ladies.
Because
I mean, that's
the nasty truth. I don't know if you know this, Jess. The nasty truth in America is that women and people who like to use women to fucking get their grift on like to say that, you know, oh, women are excluded from financial situations. Most American households are financially run by the women.
You know,
and corporate America knows that.
You know how many of my friends I have heard say this phrase unprompted from each other. I bring home the bacon, she gives it out.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but I think you're still keeping this mentality like it's 2000 and you're not hearing me in 2022, which is I need you to hear me. It's not they're not going, we don't give a fuck about men. We don't give a fuck about that. They're just going, we're going to make She-Hulk for that demographic. We're going to make a Star Wars cartoon for the tween girl demographic. Make one for the 5-year. And they don't care if there's any crossover appeal to it. That is completely think about Disney. Think about Pixar. Think about anything like that. That is completely antithetical to their fucking... Fuck their business model, their creative model.
Do they just figure dudes are in the bag if throw Star Wars on it? Dudes are going to watch it?
Last week when I read that article, that is exactly what that whistleblower said. He said it's not at Disney, Marvel, and at Lucasfilm. It's not like we hate. There are people who hate like straight. We hate straight white men, and they have jobs there. But the people in charge are just like, we got them. They're not going anywhere. So we don't need to. That's not. We need to expand, and they fucked up their expansion into fucking China. Because they were trying to play both sides of the fence by playing to the fucking woke flakes here in America and still trying to have that's having their cake, and they wanted to eat it too by doing shit like taking Finn, who was a black character in the new Star Wars movies, off of the poster and cutting out like same-sex kisses in Middle Eastern and like, you know what I'm saying, like China and shit. So that China and a lot of the Arab Emirates countries are like, fuck you. So now Disney's just come back like, fuck it. This is our new business model. I think it's fucking suicide.
Yeah. I mean,
I think it's creative suicide. I think it's business suicide. But I was wrong. Disney, one of the most powerful companies, corporations, conglomerations, however you want to put it, the universe has ever known, is willing to fucking bet everything it's worth on a marketing technique we were told first day is like asinine and will never work. It's just amazing to me. But I was wrong. And here I'm admitting it flat out. Because I just couldn't believe I it's still kind of shocking to me. Who the fuck at Disney was like, let's just make shit just for little kids. No appeal to their parents. How are you going to get parents to sit through a fucking movie? It ain't the 80s where they drop you off or let you ride your bike to the movie theater these days. You know what I'm saying? We'll be back in 2 hours.
Well, I mean, we do decide we'd be like, just put on a screen here, watch this.
Well, that's the other thing, but that's just because Disney's also focusing. Quality's out the window. You can, if you get a good quality Disney product that comes out of Disney from here on out, consider yourself lucky because Disney's obsessed with content. They, because of their streaming service, they have to have new shit. Every X amount of days or weeks or whatever. This is all, by the way, this is the metrics they're coming up with. I haven't seen these metrics. This is just their like business model. And the fact that whistleblowers have been leaking information about this for months, and then Disney comes out, and like I said, this new Star Wars Disney Plus show, I mean, they just completely mask off. Like, it is literally being advertised like Disney for grown-ups, for grown people. Like the radio station that would play, like, R&B from the 70s and 80s. R&B for grown folks. You know, like here in Detroit. Disney, Star Wars for grown folks. Come get your free cup.
I mean, well, time will tell, right? It'll be the receipts. They start hemorrhaging subscribers.
I mean, haven't they already been doing that, though?
No.
Really? I thought they were way down.
No, that was Netflix, I believe.
Well, Netflix took a hit. I don't know about Disney Plus, but I know that HBO Max is going to fold and is going to merge with, I believe, Discovery's, which is Discovery Warner Brothers Discovery now, to have a streaming service.
Well, I think it's just going to finally just be HBO. Like, why do you... Like, trust me, when they came out with HBO Max, we're like, well, don't you already have HBO online?
Well, here's... I mean, this is real industry nerd shit, but here's the issue. All these old shows that all these streaming services have, even if they didn't produce, especially the ones they didn't produce, they have to pay royalties on when they show.
Yeah, well, it's the new syndication, right?
Yes. So it costs them money to keep, like, Scrubs or Boondocks or Modern Family, whatever the fuck, on HBO Max or whatever. So it's just cheaper in the long run, and they can have content that they can just leave the fuck up if they produce it on their own. The problem is when you run into, like, what Amazon's doing. Amazon's dumped, I've heard, like, $2 billion all told so far into this Lord of the Rings television show that they literally have hired the actors, the cast, the crew for the next 5 years to make, like, the five seasons or whatnot. And this thing's fucking tanking. Like, but Amazon's entire, like, they're betting their entire streaming Amazon Studios on this being successful. And this is what these streaming services are doing. And Disney is looking at that going, we're Disney. We can take a little from everybody. I think that's what I hope. I hope. I don't really care. I don't own stock in Disney. I don't give a fuck what Disney does. But I'm just saying, like, I hope that there's some, like, logic behind what they're doing, because if not, we got madmen at the helms of fucking corporations. And if these are the best business minds the world can produce, we're fucked, is what I'm getting at, basically. So at least by every fucking expert's prediction I've ever fucking heard.
Apparently it was a bunch of rumors that they lost about 500,000 subscriptions.
Disney Plus?
Yes, but there's nothing to back that up.
Well, the other thing is streaming services, their numbers, I believe, everything is collected, reported, and released to, or collected, assembled for presentation and then presented by the streaming company. There's no independent third party that comes in.
I'm sure there's no bias at all.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I know, right? Like, so wait a minute. If the cops beat the shit out of somebody, who investigates the cops? The cops. Wait, what?
Yeah.
Because I'm going to tell you what, my buddy got busted for selling weed. And if I sent my other buddy over who sells weed to investigate him, they ain't going to find shit to fucking charge him with. I can tell you that right now.
Right, yeah.
Save everybody a trip. I mean, just putting that out there.
Just two innocent guys talking about plants.
Yeah, they're into horticulture.
Yeah.
Apparently. So, yeah, there was that, and then me just being wrong in general. Jess, have you kept up at all on House of the Dragon?
I have made it to episode 3, and it is not because I don't enjoy it. It is because I am tired.
No, I got you. First couple episodes, I had said, like, the CGI and some of the effects and all that look kind of janky. Definitely season 5. I'm like, oh, I think I found where the wardrobe budget went. When we get to that episode, I'm like, ooh, wow, I sound like an idiot. Because I'm willing to bet, I'm not joking, $5 million on wardrobe. Because all of that shit had to be handmade. Like, the sets, all that shit. These weren't existing fucking, like, so apparently these are castles they go. And they fucking, like, build the sets around an actual castle, and they do all everything like it was back in the day, like, would have been done. So this is, like, hand stitched together and beads stitched together and shit like that. And
it's like a blacksmith on the payroll.
Yeah, yeah. And for whatever reason, like, it wasn't on full display for the first couple episodes, and some of the digital effects looked a little wonky and high, and like really good definition, high definition. So I was like, looks like they're cutting corners. No, I was wrong.
Oh, you just getting an apology tour from you?
Yeah. Well, hey, man, because you know what? Because here's the deal. Whether it's stupid, whether it's silly, we sit here on this show and we fucking rightfully take pot shots at motherfuckers who go out on a limb and put themselves out there and make predictions and all this shit, but then never have. Oh, and especially when they fucking get the one time they're right, they fucking harp on it constantly. I don't know. We might have a co-host like that on that show. And then you want to ignore the plethora of times they were fucking wrong. Okay, no, I'm not that guy. I was wrong about this shit, and these are subjects I've harped on either in the past or recently, and it's like, hey, fair is fair, right is right. If I can hand lumps out, I got to be able to take them. So, yeah, I was absolutely wrong about that. I mean, I'm happy to be about the Game of Thrones show because fuck it. If I was right, it's a bad show that looks like shit. Nobody wins. If I'm wrong, everybody wins. I'm happy to be wrong.
There you go.
I'll report back to you next week when I hit that episode.
But I will say this, though. I get the feeling that this is I haven't read these books that the story came from. But apparently this is like almost like an appendix, like, or a history book within the world of Game of Thrones that told this story that they've adapted. And I almost feel like, I think this season and maybe another season, I think it feels like a mini series. Jess, do you know what a mini series is? Or is that another thing that like you just don't know?
No, I know what a mini series is.
Okay. I'm not trying to, because like, seriously, when the fuck is the last time network television had a miniseries? It was probably a Stephen King one. It was probably in the 2000s.
Yeah.
That's my guess.
I go with that. That sounds right.
Isn't that like the same thing as a limited series?
Yes.
Yeah, Inventing Anna. That came on Netflix. It was big. It was awesome.
Oh, see, I don't know.
No, the
nomenclature.
The kids have rebranded it. Yeah, it's a limited series.
They've rebranded everything. And that's another thing. Get prepared because it's coming. One of these days, it's going to be a big segment of this episode. And I'm gonna put the fucking millennials on trial and I'm make Jess fucking be their defense lawyer.
Oh, boy.
I don't accept these terms.
Well, you better be sick. You better be sick on that day. That's why I'm not going to tell you today. I'm just going to be like, it's the day. Guess what, Aaron Brockovich? Get your fucking law books out. Let's go.
Bitch. That's fine.
All right. So, yeah. So now that my apology tour is done. Sorry. I apologized. All right. What else?
The inflation is coming at a bad time for Joe Biden.
Well, it's already here, right? It's not coming anyway. Did it tick back up?
I mean, it's still ticking up, right? It hasn't turned down at all.
Remember, he said in July there was no inflation.
Right, but then he passed the Inflation Relief Act.
Mm-hmm. And the world is saved.
Yes. But now, as of today, they had to raise the federal interest rate again to combat the inflation that's not happening. So if anyone can make this make sense, please.
Trying to.
I like the quote from that article you sent, Chris, about the inflation coming at a bad time, saying the stock market doesn't necessarily reflect the state of the economy.
Oh, yeah. Yes, it fucking does. That is the biggest indicator we have. Like, I've even said it on this show, like when Earl was, you know, one of the many times Earl was talking about the fall of Western civilization and it was beginning and this and that. It's like, no, you know, I'll be worried. If the stock market goes to hell, that's when I start getting worried. Like, that is, at least in this country, that is our economic indicator.
All right. So, speaking as a total fucking idiot when it comes to stocks, I always thought the stock market was, well, you just said it. I mean, this might be pedantic on my part, but I thought it was more of an indicator of confidence.
Well, that too.
The current state and the immediate future confidence in the economy that businesses have.
Yes. Okay. All of the above. Okay. But if you just track history, anytime we've gone through any economic turmoil in this country, the stock market's been in the shitter.
I mean, I would think so. I mean, it's kind of stock market.
Well, according
not
to,
a financial genius, but it's tied to the economy somehow, isn't it?
Not according to President Grandpa.
I mean, do we even need to address that?
Right.
I mean, like, we kind of just know, right? It is what it is at this point.
So, some interesting things that I, because I, sorry, I got a little jumbled. When I got home from work today, they were giving a speech. I caught this back end of a live speech from Powell, some Federal Reserve person, and he was talking about the the federal interest rate going up by 0.75%. And there, I caught the back end of it where it was just a lot of Q&A, and he was talking about how this was going to be hard on the American people, how that this was going to be something we just have to like basically buckle in and get through, and hopefully in a couple of years this would be something that would level out inflation. And the stock market kept being brought up, so then I looked into that, and whenever the Federal Reserve raises the interest rate, the stock market, that lowers the confidence in the stock market, and people pull out, and it causes problems. So this is, I don't see how this is going to help inflation.
Because what they want to discourage it. It's happened several times, and it works. It's they want people to stop spending money. They want to drive, it's supply and demand. They want to drive demand down. They want to make auto loans and mortgage rates and credit card interest rates. They want those rates to go up so people stop, so people cool their jets.
But people have already had to do that.
Yeah, they want to keep it going. I mean, that's what pulled us out of it. If you look back, it's what pulled us out of 2008. They had to raise a rate for a while, and it stabilized the economy. It cooled people's jets. They literally are trying to discourage people from making bigger purchases.
But people can't. I don't personally, and I mean, back in 2008, it was different. I was at a different time in my life, and I didn't know a lot of people going out and getting mortgages. Or taking out car loans. But I don't know a lot of people. I know a lot, most of the people I know who have been in the market to move have been not capable of doing so because of the prices.
Yes, and this will drive demand down, which will drive the prices down. Like, if demand for mortgages goes down, then demand for housing goes down, then the prices, that's, yes.
That's the whole point.
My house should not be worth what it's worth right now. I'm straight up, like, dude, my house should not be worth almost $250,000. And at some point this year it was. No fucking way. It's a 3-bedroom range.
Right, yes. No, I got my house whenever the housing market had crashed. And I got it for a song. I got it for nothing. Yeah. And then I ended up getting my house appraised. And the number they gave me, I was like, did you look? Like, did you send an appraiser out to my house. Did you actually look, or did you just take a stab, throw some random numbers on a page, close your eyes and hit the keyboard? Because that's not right.
No, yeah. I mean, what this thing was worth when I moved in compared to now. I mean, but that's, they're trying to get, they said they're trying to tap down the demand side of supply and demand. That's really what they're trying to do, raising these rates.
So is it, okay, because I think you're trying to go somewhere, Jess, and I think I know where you might be going, or something's like just fucking itching in the back of your mind and like you can't put your finger on it. Let me see if I can fucking take a guess here. There's people who are just, they're so low on the economic scale, this type of shit really doesn't matter. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you can't lose a home when you don't have a home. You know what I'm saying? Like, type thing. But then there's the young professionals, the young families, the families with the starter houses and shit. Then when shit starts affecting them, okay, then they stop spending. You're talking about raising the interest rate. You're talking about people who their entire world is pretty much them and cash probably parted ways, except for maybe $100 in their pocket in various bills years ago. Everything's on paper. You're talking about people who like a 0.75 interest rate hike seems like they're trying to get a higher tax bracket to spend less to drive demand down. Whereas Like the lower, like the low income people, we're not spending more anyways because we don't have it. There's nothing to fuck. There's no belt to tighten. Everything's going to essentials anyways for the most part. Do you see what I'm saying?
Like, no, I understand that, but still, but I guess what I'm getting at too is it can put these things more in reach for the lower income people. It could put a house back into affordability.
Long term.
Yeah.
No, I get what you.
It could make the average car payment not be $700.
I'm talking about the start of the process. This is the theory behind the thought of doing this is that this will be the fucking what will happen.
Yes.
Okay. I get. Okay.
And, so, but what is this going to do to the stock market then?
Well, it went down today because that's what happens when they raise the rate. And no, what's going to happen? It's going to be called a buying opportunity for the stock market. It's not going to collapse. I mean, we learned our lesson with subprime loans in 2008. That's part of why the bottom fell out is a bunch of people had notes that came due they couldn't afford. You know, and there was this influx of supply and demand. That's what drove costs down. All of a sudden, you had all these homes on the market that were foreclosed on. Glut of product.
So you have full confidence then that this is going to work.
Oh,
there's no way.
It's worked. It has worked many times throughout history.
Okay.
Here's the thing. Even I have said, yeah, the shit works. Is it the most efficient and the most humane way? That's where the concern comes in. And to me, like, that's where our concern should be. Like, we know it works, but we also know that there's an attrition rate that comes with, like, every percentage point unemployment goes up, like 40,000 people die or something like that on average or something, like some crazy shit like that. So, I mean, that's where you get into the refining the idea. You know what I'm saying? Like, we know it works. We know these things work. We just want to fucking reduce the cost of it working, I guess. I'm assuming that's what they're fucking, that's the goal. That's, if everyone's acting in good faith, that's the end goal, right?
Mm-hmm.
If everyone's acting in good faith.
Yes.
Yeah. And you can't see the grin that's starting to spread on my face as I say that, because that's horse shit.
It's a big if.
Could this not be perceived, though? It's just another way of, like, attacking, because, you know, millennial. But could this not be another way of attacking the middle class, though? Like, it's not going to affect the people who are lower class, and it's certainly not going to affect the upper class. So this is just another way of holding the middle class hostage until the economy does what they say it's going to do, until things bounce back.
See, but that's kind of what I was getting at. I think that's what they're doing. Like, it's not, don't think of the middle class as one monolithic group. There's levels to this shit, to say a meme phrase. Like, you know, you have like working class, which would be the bottom of the middle class. You have middle class, which is just like literally what you're saying, middle class. Like, and you have like upper middle class. Sounds like this is like aiming to curb spending and borrowing for the upper middle class and the top half of the middle class, the actual middle class. Am I making sense or no?
Yeah. And that's exactly what it is.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go. Gee, I actually know something about economics and I'm not even trying.
Yeah, because it's discouraging new purchases. It's like my mortgage rate ain't adjusting, right? I'm locked in. You know, I got a 30-year fixed. It's locked in at what I signed my contract on. My auto loan ain't adjusting. It's locked in what I signed my contract on. Like, it's to discourage new purchases to get everything to cool the fuck. Like I said, it's to slow down demand.
So, I mean, so to answer your question, yeah, it is kind of targeting them. And I mean,
and welcome to who pays all the taxes.
Yeah,
right.
I mean, it does go back to that George Carlin bit. You know, poor there. Richer, was it a big club?
And you ain't in it.
You ain't in it. And the rich, you know, hoard most of the money and blah, 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 blah. And the middle class pay all the taxes. And the poor is there to scare the shit out the middle class.
Yeah.
Don't fuck up, because here's what happens when you fuck up. That's what I said. I'm a cautionary tale. I know that. I know my station in life.
Well, whenever I was reading into this, something that Powell kept saying, I need to look up his official title.
Which, by the way, the Fed, It's federal, just like Federal Express is federal. Name only. It is a private bank. I've never understood that. But that's another conversation for another day.
He kept saying, we're gonna buckle down with it. I don't want to misquote, but he kept indicating we're going to continue with this. So I looked it up, and people are saying that what that was an indication that they're going to keep raising the interest right now. That's the indication that they are going, that this isn't the last time they're going to raise it. Apparently they review it quarterly. I think I read that right. And they're anticipating that they're going to continue raising it, that the Federal Reserve is going to continue raising the interest rate. From what he was saying, he indicated for at least another year, possibly two.
Yep.
We'll see. They said that in the last six months. The argument seemed to be like that. Seemed to be like the accepted way of going about handling this by the people who make those decisions. But the only debate seemed to be in how big of increments does it go up? Because like. I think we talked about it on the show. Might have been before you joined, but like I remember you specifically, Chris, saying something like, "If it goes up like a full percentage point, that's like whoa,
yeah,
whoa, that's drastic."
Yeah,
and like Earl and I going like, "Motherfucker, 1%, like that's a vig I take on a bet from a bookie or a loan shark." You know what I'm saying? Like, that's not that bad. But then like. You explained it, and I was like, oh, okay, I get it. I get it now.
Extra 1% over 30 years. Do the math. It's a lot of money.
Well, especially if they're raising it, like you said, and it's not, and not necessarily they're going to, like Jess, like you said, they might not be raising it every quarter, but if they raise it twice a year and they raise it a half percentage point over 2 years, you got two full percentage
points. Dude, it's the difference of hundreds of dollars a month in a mortgage payment. Like, that's how much that rate matters. Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, you know, raising it and lower, you know, when they lower it, yeah. I mean, it puts home ownership back, you know, more within reach of the lower class. But right now, a house like mine being on the market for 8 hours is not normal. That is not a normal market. And they need to just cool shit down. And surprising how it works. You know, last year we were told how putting all this money into the economy wasn't going to drive up demand for things. No. And here we are, a year later, looking at the worst inflation since the early 80s.
Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net. Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.
And also, and I haven't seen anyone complaining about this a lot yet, but also haven't been on social media a whole lot today. But I've seen, you know, again, in my digging into this and looking into this, because I don't know, obviously, a lot about economics. I have lots of questions, don't really understand stock market, don't really understand.
I'm sure millennials found a way to be victimized by it.
Probably. But what they kept saying in these articles is that the inflation was caused by COVID, by shutdowns, and by Ukraine. And then I saw some place that said a strong labor market, which, right?
Yeah.
Well, I think that was in the article I sent.
Well, by COVID, do they mean giving everybody a pile of money and then it being pumped into the economy and it driving up the demand for everything? Yeah, then sure, COVID.
Well, and the printing of money to be, yeah, like you're saying, for that and for Ukraine, right? Like, we have to take that into consideration, don't we?
The Ukraine's being the goat at this time around for gas prices, which we were always told we get all of our oil from the Middle East. Now apparently we get it all from Russia.
Of course. But no, like, where am I just not? Have I just not seen the stuff yet? Is that how that's going? Have I not seen the people who are angry about this yet? About, you know, they printed all the money and now they're saying, and oh, by the way, like, we're raising the interest rates on everything.
Well, for the most part, you're not going to see people who are upset about all that, like, marching in the streets because they have money. That's why they're upset about it. You're also fucking with their money.
And also generally jobs.
And
they got shit to do.
People with that type of money, they ain't really going to go out in the streets and start fucking throwing, like, bricks and IEDs at fucking Proud Boys' heads. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's just not their, that's not the vibe. But I like, it just comes, it, I just think, like, it, this is this is what we do, right? This is how we handle recessions. This is how we handle all this shit. This is just what we do. And I'm just like, you're asking questions and I'm just like, I have no idea to answer any of these questions because none of this shit even mattered to me until I was in my 30s. And here's the deal. It didn't matter to me in my 30s because I cared about it. It mattered to me because a lot of people around me cared about it. So I was like, I guess I better attempt to learn something about this.
I'll tell you what, Jess, it might work because I was thinking about moving over the fall and winter. Now I'm thinking about not moving over the fall and winter.
Oh, same. Well, I've been looking into moving. I mean, this was supposed to be our starter home. We were supposed to stay here for just, you know, five-ish years. And I can't afford it. Can't do it.
All right. Well, is that a wrap on the Fed and the interest rate?
I mean, I guess so.
We're all poor.
Wait, hold on. No, I have one more question. How is this going to help the price and the inflation on other things that are not houses and cars and credit cards? How is this going to help with, like, will this help with grocery prices, or are we just stuck with those?
Trying to think of how. I mean, this is for bigger purchases. I mean, the other thing is that, I mean, groceries, that stuff's driven by, like, the price of commodities and shit like that. I mean, if the whole economy adjusts, right, I would adjust it up. It'll allegedly adjust back down, right? Like, steak's $25 a pound now. You know, hopefully it goes back to $13 a pound because gas is not $5 a gallon. You know, it's not costing as much to produce it.
Is that going to be because demand for gas is lower because no one can afford a car?
Oh, I mean, you have people. You're going to have people doing things less. You're not going to have people traveling. Trust me, people's lifestyles, they alter their. You know, you don't just alter one thing. You alter kind of like your whole deal.
Okay.
I mean, again, it's worked in the past. It's all I'm good. It's all I got.
Well, I mean, no, I'm not just trying to, like, come at you over mm-hmm. it. I really am asking to understand because I've got a very mild understanding of this today, but you even have helped me understand at least what the train of thought.
Even mine is just limited knowledge, and it's really all supply and demand. They just want people to stop all that money they got out there moving around. They want it to stop moving around for a while. Short answer.
Fair enough.
Get shit to all calm right. the fuck down.
Well.
Said the average car payment shouldn't be $700. That is what it is right now.
That really what it is?
Yes.
Holy that shit.
It's insane. $700 a month? I better be driving a fucking Porsche.
Right? Damn. Okay. Well, I'll study more into it. If I come across anything interesting or if I can argue with you better, I'll save it for next week.
There you go.
Okay, moving on to a lighter topic. 20,000 transgender Americans are facing voting barriers.
Yeah, this was a fun read.
It was a great read.
And what are these voting barriers, Jess?
that they don't have IDs that reflect their names or their prescribed names or genders.
So, last I checked, ID in Michigan's fucking $13. What, they don't have $13?
I guess. I mean, I'm sure there's like some sort of loophole you have to jump through to go change your name completely or to go change your gender, right?
Can we do cost analysis of gender reassignment surgery versus a new ID?
Well, fair. And also, if you're talking about transitioning, if someone wants to go to the trouble to transition, right? File the paperwork.
Yeah, cross the T's. Cross your T's, dot your I's. Chop your nuts off.
Whatever. It's going to set them up for discrimination. It's going to set them up to be ridiculed, that more efforts should be put into, what was it? Like, basically diversity training for poll workers, for like the volunteers that are poll workers. They need to all be trained on how to handle whenever a man walks in and hands you a card with a woman on it, on how to be sensitive. Sensitivity training. That's what I was looking for.
How about you're the one making the choice? You're the one that should do all the fucking work.
Or just go in and give them your ID and say your name. Like, I might go by... What? Lil Shawty, but you know, my legal name is Tammy, you know, whatever.
Or just go to, like, if you're going through the whole rigmarole, go through the whole fucking thing. Change the ID, get the new picture, fill out the new paperwork with the fucking county clerk. Why do we have to, why do we have to adjust to you?
Okay. I also feel like they're probably given, like, pamphlets for this, right? Like, once you get through with your surgery, you know, when I had a baby, they sent me home with a pamphlet, the do's and don'ts. Here's how you get the birth certificate. This is how you do this.
So you have a dick now.
Yes.
No, well, you don't get
any. Proud odor of a dick.
No, no. If you chop your dick off, that's when you're fucking buried in free literature. When you become a guy, they're like, figure it out for yourself like we did, motherfucker.
Oh, so you don't have a dick now. That would be the pamphlet.
Yes, yes. Because if you got a dick, like, seriously, you, like, a bitch gets her first period and the government sends her a pamphlet and fucking Walmart sends her a free fucking selection of tampons to a sample and all this bullshit. What the fuck do guys get? Nothing.
I got a razor and a draft card. That's what I got at 18.
Oh, you got a razor? Must have been nice to have a father teach you to shave. I dry shave for
No, it came in the mail.
Oh. Yeah, I dry shave for the first 3 years I shaved because I didn't have any mail around to teach me that I needed to fucking lather my face.
Yeah.
There you go. But anyways, here's my question.
Chris shut that one down and then you had to take it home. We were still there.
You don't know about friction?
What the fuck is 20,000? That's the number, right?
200,000.
200,000. Okay.
Yes.
I want to see it. I want to see the receipts. I want to see where 200,000 people have had a problem trying to vote because they're transgendered and their license didn't reflect their new identity.
Well, that's not what the article was saying. What the article was saying
they
is
could.
That yes, there's 20,000 transgender people in the 36 states that require ID to be shown.
I'm sorry. I know I'm being a stickler, but you did it again. You said 20,000. Did you mean 200,000?
I meant 200. I swore I said, I'm sorry. Okay. Yes, I meant 200,000.
All right. That's why I want clarification, because 20,000...
No.
I listened to you say that number incredulously to begin with. You keep adding zeros, and I'm just like, okay, now I need fucking receipts. And
20
million. What I'm
200 million.
What 200 billion.
Sorry.
Are we counting stars now? Yeah. Are stars people? I mean, even if we count all the corporations on the planet and we give them corporate personhood, we don't have 200 billion. But okay. No, because I was taking the long way around to get to the point that Chris made, which is, and you both jumped in on, which is could, if, maybe. Okay. Well, I mean, aren't these the same people that say that there's no such thing as the slippery slope fallacy?
Oh, there's a lot of news stories that talk about shit that could happen. A lot. I see them all the fucking time.
Matt Taibbi brought it up. He has a term, or I don't know if it's his term or he just adopted the term or he's using it, but I think it's like speculative journalism it's an actual subgenre of journalism that was laughed at, pointed at, and like basically one step above writing for the National Enquirer 20, 30 years ago. And now it's the mainstream way to do journalism because this is all dependent on supply and demand. We eat this shit up. And when I say we, I do mean human beings as a group eat this shit up. That's why they give it to us.
I'm trying to see how many stories in my feed right now have a could or a might.
But I will say this. We're fed a steady diet of these fucking, you know, speculative journalism, whatever the fuck, or whatever. I might even have the term wrong, but I'm just going to go with speculative journalism, and we're going to use that. Okay? My question is, people eat it up, and we go, well, that's what they want, and that's the free market, and that's how the free market works, and duh. And it's like, okay, yeah, great, but if they don't know that they have something else that they could eat off of the menu... And they've never been like, you know, the waiter isn't telling them, you know, you don't have to order the same thing every time you come in here. We have a menu. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, maybe, no, not, no traction. Okay. All right. Guess not all analogies can be winners. I don't know. Whatever.
Well, like, what's the menu? It's like the menu's information in my book.
People don't even know what it's like to get stone cold facts, like in the AP wire way that we did when we went through fucking school. That's what I'm talking about. They don't know how to process that. Watch someone try to watch a news story from 20 years ago and watch how fucking quickly they get disinterested and their mind wanders. Their finger fucking their phone, their eyes are off the screen within fucking 2-3 seconds. It's just like there's...
What are all these... Why are they just hitting me with facts?
And I'm just like, what the fuck? Like, I've seen it. Like, you can go on YouTube and, like, find reaction channels of people reacting to, like, news stories from, you know, a couple decades ago and shit like this. And for those of us who were alive and remember... And we're aware of what was going on. It's amazing to watch people go, you can't sit through a 45-second news story because it's too fucking much to ask. Because it's not going. News stories went from who, what, where, when, how, why, whatever the fuck, mm-hmm. to this product is in your home and could kill your entire family. Tune in at 11 for more. That's what the fuck news is now. Mm-hmm. That's not news. That's fear-produced teasers.
Yeah.
That's all it is.
Fear porn.
Yes.
But our brains are designed now to crave that.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Like it.
Well, they've always been designed to crave it. They've just figured out how to tap into it.
Yeah, fair.
Well, it's easier because it's an easy fucking dollar. And I mean, like, that's the dirty little secret. Like, it's not maximized profit. It's maximized profit with minimum amount of fucking effort. That's the fucking true fucking thing that they're looking for. And it's like... Why would we spend money hiring journalists and actually, I don't know, have to fact check and shit when we could just put three idiots who look good on camera and talk for 2 hours about what might happen? And that's what they do.
Mm-hmm.
And if that's all that you've ever ate and you have no idea that there's like other fucking food on the menu, yes, I'm going back to that because goddamn it, it's apt. I don't give a fuck. I'm right on this one.
So where is the menu though? Where can I get?
But that's
news
the thing, Rich.
Just facts.
Yeah, if the restaurant's been burned down, how are you eating off the menu?
And that's the other thing. You're not going to a restaurant now. Now you're going to pop up restaurants.
Yeah,
shit's the delivery method has changed while you've been stuck on your one fucking thing you always get.
Oh, you know what?
Taco.
One thing I'll say: Facebook News. I'll tell you what. Why? Because in Facebook News, there is the regular one from all the things you've heard of. And then you get to a thing at the bottom. What's it called here? Independent creators, independent voices. And this is where you start hearing from, like, shit you've never heard of. Like, yeah, government executive. Heavy on Eagles. Confidence in joy. Like, shit, just blogs and shit you've never fucking heard of.
No, I got you. And, dude, where do they go? Where do you go for anything anymore? The problem is just like when people talk about the music sucks these days. No, there's good music out there. But the music industry, it doesn't – there's no profit in presenting a wide range, an eclectic range of fucking music anymore via the pop charts at least. It's just not. Now, you can go and dig into, like, boutique labels – like, there's a label called Southern Lord that handles a lot of doom and stoner and black metal and stuff in the from the States, at least. And, like, they make a living selling a very, like, niche product. Like, that's not something that's ever going to be on the Hot 100. You're never going to see a Sleep's Dope Smoker on the top 20 album charts.
I don't know what that is.
Yeah, exactly. You know what I'm saying? You're not going to see Electric Witch on the top 20 charts, you know what I'm saying? None of these bands, but there are ways to do it. So you just have to look in different places. The problem is that it's the Wild West once you get away from the big fucking media distributors. Once you get away from the YouTubes, once you get away from the social media, the Twitters, you get into like, what is it, Gab or like the alternate YouTube substitutes or Rumble. Alternatives. Rumble, yeah, shit like that. And that's just... Man, you don't know what the fuck you're getting.
Yeah.
So you could get something that's produced as well as CNN that's absolute bullshit, and you can get something that looks like literally someone with a fucking standard definition fucking webcam from 2002, and it's the most accurate and factual news you're ever going to fucking see. but you wouldn't know if to look at it for 2 seconds. One's going to fool the eye, and the other's going to fucking fool the eye, but it's actually, you know what I'm saying? Like,
one's the food cart with the handwritten signs,
you know,
in Sharpie.
About. Yes, exactly.
And the other ones, you know, they got the nice printed signs and all, but the guy with the Sharpie sign makes the best fucking shit you've ever had.
Because I'm fat, and let's stick with the food metaphors. The flashy, good, well-produced news segment that has nothing, that's just absolute garbage, mm-hmm. It's unsweetened chocolate. It smells and it looks great. Boy, you put that shit in your mouth, it'll be the last time you eat bacon chocolate.
Yeah, yeah. Terrible.
I'm just saying.
Bitter. So. Get out of my mouth.
Yep.
But also, just to kind of counter your point, like, I know there's news out there that's available, but it's discounted by anyone that you may try to talk to. So, you know, whenever you have someone who's like, okay, you're telling me this, cite your sources, and you're like, well, it was on such and such blog, you know, like, no one's going to listen to you.
Well, that's mainstream media has a vested interest in keeping independent news sources basically from growing. And I mean, like, one of the ways,
the competition,
easiest way to do it is to discredit them. So I mean, like stuff like that, I kind of expect. That's when you have to, I'm not one of these people that's like, it's all on you. No, there's in broadcast, and especially in journalism, there is a set of ethics. I don't care how postmodern we get up our own ass about shit, and how much we, you know, eschew fucking objective fucking reality anymore. You can't just make shit up in the journalism fucking world. And I feel like a lot of people are walk around claiming the title of journalist, and news outlets are claiming the title of news, like we're a trusted news source, we're a trusted news outlet. Who are you? Where were you 6 months ago? I mean, that's why, like, Crystal and Sagar, when they left The Hill, they were on The Hill for fucking years together. And they were, and also, and I mean, like, you know, Crystal's, like, she's almost our age, so she's in her mid-40s, and I think Sagar's, like, in his mid-30s. And they had media careers before. They had a background, so when they started their own media channel, their receipts were fucking available for the public. You could go, well, what have they been right and wrong about? Here's everything.
Yeah.
Go take a fucking look. And you know what? When they're wrong, they admit it. And when they're right, they don't rub it in your face. They don't take a fucking victory lap. They just go, act accordingly, and let's move on. So, yeah.
They built a little thing called credibility.
Exactly. Exactly. And I think that's what's been lost. And like, a lot of the shit, when you're talking about, like, those like, off, I guess, for lack of a better term, off-brand,
like BuzzFeed, right? I don't understand why BuzzFeed is considered a trusted news. Why does the website that asks me what fucking friend I take the friends quiz, figure out which friend you are? What? How is that a trusted news source?
It's like with comic book nerds when I was growing up. If it wasn't Marvel or DC, a lot of comic book like nerds would be like, I don't want nothing to do with it. So, you know what I'm saying? Like if it's not like the shiny packaged presented thing, they don't want it. Does that make sense? Or
yeah,
okay,
yeah. Yeah.
And it's like I don't. There's a lot to it, but I mean, like, you have to understand, like, a lot of what's going on that gets painted as political posturing is just that. It's just bullshit. It's a smokescreen to cover up what's really going on behind the scenes. Like, case in point, real quick, without getting too deep into it, the comic book world. You have a lot of old school comic book artists and writers who are being basically shown the door because the new crew, the new generation's coming in, and their politics are what we bitch about on this show every week. So, you know, their politics, and the old crew has to fucking play politics to even possibly keep their fucking job. You know what I'm saying? And so it becomes like they learn to play the game. The ones that go, fuck it, I'm going to play this game because I'm not going to give up a career I've worked my entire life for. Just because some snot-nosed, blue-haired cocksucker shows up and says he's fucking demisexual, whatever the fuck that means, you know?
He's the only fucks girls named Demi.
You have to learn to play the game, and part of playing the game is learning to shield yourself behind certain things that are bulletproof. And all this woke bullshit is bulletproof when it's really, I think that's used as a fucking shield for a lot of these old timers to keep their jobs. And that's a lot of what's going on in media, especially legacy media or mainstream media, because you have a changing of the guard. Like we had it about 20 years ago, the Dan Rather, Ted Koppel.
Tom Brokaw.
Them stepping aside. And who's homeboy lied about everything?
Oh, Brian Williams.
Yeah, and
that was only 10 years ago.
The hot chick, yeah, but he started coming to prominence, mm-hmm. as the old guard was retiring. That's what I'm saying. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
we're kind of in that cycle again. We're in that 20-year cycle again now. That's what's going on, and a lot of it's being a lot of what this like I said, this politicizing of shit. It's really posturing and smoke screens for people to keep their jobs and not lose their career.
Yeah.
I mean, that's really what it is.
There's a game and they're playing it.
And I mean, like,
22-year-olds are calling the shots now. Shit, guess I better figure this out.
Well, that's why I said when I was talking about, like, that's why I argued for so many years that no, there's no way a corporation like Disney or Lucas Films or Time Warner is going to go, we don't care if we lose money. We're pandering to this group and this group only. And it's like,
lose enough money, they'll care.
Well, here's the thing. They just tweaked it a bit. They're like, really, if we don't aim to get you, we're not losing money because we were never trying to get you. Can't lose what you never wanted, right? Like, it's almost sour grapes, isn't it? Like, but, I didn't want you in the first place.
But no, but isn't it? But I guess wasn't there hubris in there, too? Like, no, we don't even need to try. You're already there.
Well, no, yeah. Every leak and shit like that. Yeah,
we just got to write.
Very much been the.
We just got to write Star Wars on it, and you're going to fucking be there, Whitey.
Yeah, no, middle-aged white men. They're like, we got them. We don't need to do anything else. They're hooked.
Mm-hmm.
They're hooked. They got their Funko Pops. They buy T-shirts. They buy all the fucking toys. You know what's amazing is. I know I'm getting off on a tangent here, but I find this hilarious that you go into like whatever toy stores, brick and mortar toy stores are still around. Apparently there are a few. I guess you can go into like Walmart or like something like that, Target. They got toy sections, but like there's videos online of people going in and they still have toys from The Last Jedi. I mean, clogging the shelves like a fucking 1,000-pound dude's arteries. I mean, just, dude, there it's like they can't get rid of it. They got fucking like these action figures that are like a foot to maybe a foot and a half tall somewhere they're huge and they're highly detailed and articulate and they wanted like 50, 60 bucks when they first come out. Shits are on clearance for like 3-4 bucks. Basically like, man, just come take these fucking things.
Please.
Please. We'll give them to you. You know? I mean, and I'm just going, dude, even the fucking prequel movies, they couldn't keep toys on the shelves. I know I was working at Toys R Us, working midnight stocking the fucking things. I know. You know what I'm saying?
Your personal beef with Jar Jar?
Oh, yeah, for many reasons, but yeah. So, yeah, needless to say, there's a lot of factors into the new situation. And, I mean, I think the ultimate situation when it comes to any news anymore is, who can you believe? Who can you trust? Because even if you find some trusted sources, where are they getting their news from? Because we learned this on Sporgy more than a few times. It's not about getting the story right. It's about reporting it first.
Mm-hmm.
And we got caught up on some sports breaking news stories when we were on the air about trades and I think a few signings and announced them and talked about them for a segment only to have the next day the article that we all read, that we all saw, completely be fucking scrubbed from the internet.
Dude, I saw a fucking thing on Instagram the other day, straight up, after Dak Prescott got injured. I don't know who the fuck posted this, but it just came up in a little... I don't know if you're familiar with Instagram, but there's like a page where like it'll bring up pictures of like related to all the shit that you like follow or have looked at.
Okay.
And it was just a meme... from some no-name sports site or whatever that picture a Cap in a fucking Dallas uniform. Did the Cowboys sign Colin Kaepernick? All three of us know that is incredibly false. That did not happen.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's the kind of shit that goes down.
Yeah, and I mean, like, when people go, it's just sports, who cares? Or it's entertainment news, who cares?
And it wasn't
because
even,
it spreads like a fucking cancer.
And it wasn't even someone trying to be funny. It was, or maybe it was, but it was made to look like it was an actual like breaking news kind of gif or meme or whatever the fuck you're supposed to call them. No, I'm sorry, gifs move. I'm not that old. I understand what happens.
But no, I'm with you, man. I've seen that type of shit. I've been sucked in. Shit, we got sucked in by, I know for a fact, ESPN reported one story, and then fucking ESPN actually ran a retraction on their website, though. But I think it was like, it was either CBS or Fox, and it was an NFL story. And they just fucking, they took the fucking link down, and they never said shit about it. And I was like, I know we all didn't have mass hysteria and imagine that.
Right.
Because, like, we were all three in separate rooms recording, reading articles on separate devices. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it's like, we didn't imagine this shit. Anyways. Yeah. So that's a big factor. There's a, look, man, I'm just going to, fuck it. Tinfoil hat time. I don't give a fuck. It's near the end of the show. Let's get down in the dirt here. This shit feels like, a lot of times when we start talking about this shit, I'm like, man, I'm not saying this shit's by design. But one motivated person with enough fucking money to pay people on his payroll could really fucking start maneuvering shit around to his advantage or their advantage or the corporation they work for, whatever's fucking government they're representing.
You mean like manipulating an election to have the results that you want?
I'm talking about everything, dude. I'm talking about the whole thing. The media complex completely. I'm talking about the entertainment side, the news side. The fucking false bullshit that you'll hear in the media about the culture war is bullshit. Like, I love Crystal and Sagar on Breaking Points. I love their channel. I love, like, even though Crystal's damn near a communist and Sagar's a fucking, well, he's kind of like a classical liberal, but that's a conservative / fascist these days. Like, I love him, but I mean, I don't know. I lost where I was going with that. Sorry.
Tinfoil hatting us.
A lot of this shit just feels like it's being set up, like not on purpose, but like if we're starting to see dots that can be connected, then motherfuckers whose job it is to obsess about this shit and make sure shit turns out in certain people's favor have to be seeing the same fucking ability. Like these dots wouldn't take much to connect these dots here. We could make this happen. Like it has to be happening, dude. You know what I'm saying? Like it's just too... There's too much manipulation in the media. Mark Zuckerberg went on Joe Rogan and admitted the FBI came and told him to stop fucking letting people post about Hunter Biden.
Yeah. And you notice how that was just a blip in the news cycle? That should have been a huge fucking story. Dude, I'm telling the rabbit I was chasing that when we talked about that was like we were so mad that a foreign country interfered in our election. We apparently have no problem with our own country interfering with our own election results.
Well, and it's just, we've been conditioned, like Pavlovian style conditioned to have no fucking attention span. The fact that in 2016, when the left was screaming and the Democrats was screaming, oh, well, Trump and Republicans stole the election, and Trump and Republicans were like, what proof do you have? The Democrats, maybe even a co-host on the show that we were doing at the time said, well, there's no election where there's not any type of election. Every election has election fraud, blah, 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 blah. And then yet these same fucking people in 2000,
right.
This is the cleanest election that's ever been run. There was no fraud.
Mm-hmm.
None was. I brought up the fact that maybe somebody could have pushed through like 1,500 ballots to try to fucking like, you know, stack the odds, and I was shouted down. And I'm like, but 4 years ago, you were arguing the exact opposite of this.
Trust me, I also asked a question that I apparently wasn't supposed to ask. Well, what's to stop me from mailing in? If they're not checking this shit, they're not, when I show up at the polls, what's to stop them from, I could have mailed in my vote and then went and voted. There was no checks and balances there. I wasn't allowed to ask that question.
No, it's problematic. How dare you fucking point out the glaring holes you could drive semi through in our plane.
I got two mail ballots upstairs for me and my wife at the time. What's to stop me from just mailing both those in and then going voting again?
Charlie LaDuff. He's like, me and my family live in a house we've lived in Detroit for going on 20 years. Person I bought the house from, I guess they lived in it for 25 years, somewhere around there. He got mail-in ballots in 2020 for his family, the entire family who was registered to vote who lived there before, and the people who lived there before them who have had to have been dead for a good 40 years.
Right.
And he's like, I called the city of Detroit. What do you want me to do with these ballots? And they're like, what do you want us to do? Throw them away. He's like, if I was dishonest, I could have just filled them out and sent them in. I don't know if they'd have counted them.
All for Trump. That's how I know Charlie.
But I mean, like, he's like, he flat out, he pointed out, he's like, I could have sent in multiple ballots.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what would have happened. But the fact that I just said that and nobody cares, everybody should be pissed about.
Yeah.
But nobody cares. Nobody cares. No. Doesn't matter.
Well, it's not that no one cares. You weren't allowed to say it. If you said it, you were a conspiracy theorist. If you said it, you were just pissed off. Just, you know, take your loss.
This is, okay. This is why, like, I'm sorry. This is going to be like a hashtag fucking cause for me. This is why I am so fucking over all this. You mad? You mad, ain't you? You know what? Yes, I'm mad. Someone fucked me over. The proper and perfectly normal and rational response to that is to be upset. I hate this attitude of anybody who shows any emotion about anything is automatically you lose. Why?
Mm-hmm.
With no emotion, you fucking losers wouldn't be here. Because I've seen everyone's parents. They ain't that hot. They had to be in love to fuck. Because your mama ugly. I hate to tell you. Someone got, I got the heart. They ain't got the heart. You got ugly parents, bro. Like, that's just sorry. Or bitch, or whatever, whoever's listening. Like, odds are
that baby ugly.
Yep, exactly. Odds are you did not have playboy models and playgirl or Chippendale models for parents. So yeah, emotion, art, get rid of it. Music, get rid of it. Writing, get rid of it. All of it. Just no emotion. No emotion. Got to be emotionless, automaton, robotic people. I don't understand that, especially coming from the generation who cries and is obsessed with their motherfucking cock-sucking feelings. But they want everyone to show, no, you mad, aren't you? You mad. You lost.
Well, you can only show feelings if they're the right feelings for the right cause.
Yet, once again, this your generation is a generation who walks around beating the drum saying, don't tell us how to feel. So how can there be right and wrong feelings? God damn it, defend your generation!
I can't. Let's go. I don't want to even pretend like I can. Lock them up.
You understand that you're part of that, right? I mean, I'm just saying, like, and a lot, and pretty much everyone you know in your, like, around you would be locked up, too.
Lock them up. Lock them up.
Yeah, and I don't know if your parents, I mean, they're Gen X parents, they might not put no money on your commissary. You know what I'm saying? So you're just sitting in prison with a bunch of pissed off millennials and no survival skills in prison.
I know the millennial loophole. I just don't identify as a millennial. It's fine.
Oh, okay. Is that how that?
Yes.
Isn't that convenient? Yes.
Well, should we identify the show as done?
Yeah, I guess we're knocking on the door 2 hours here.
Yeah.
All right. Well, you know the drill. Find us on social media at Gen Exhausted Pod on Twitter. Same thing on Facebook where you can like us. Hit the PayPal button, the Amazon banner on the Christopher Media on thechristophermedia.net because I'm 75. If you'd like to help us out and wherever you listen to us, rate us, review us if you have that ability. 5 stars, 1 stars, just rate and review. That's how you help people find the show. Please and thank you. That's how you do things in 2022. Thank you for listening. I'll see you next week.
Later, guys.
Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.